This is Ken Ryan. Be watching next Sunday at 8 when Global presents A Case of Libel, starring Ed Asner, Daniel J. Travanti, and Gordon Pinsent. A somber Caldwell recounts his past lovers and says farewell to St. Eligius on St. Elsewhere. Tomorrow at 10 on the Global Television Network.
Rescue workers at the train crash site in Alberta reached the lead car of the passenger train. The vote count in the Philippines continues amid charges of fraud. And Canadians who fled the troubled country of Haiti arrive home.
This is the national edition of Global News with Jan Tennant.
Good evening. Three different investigations have been launched into the train crash that claimed 29 lives in the Rocky Mountain foothills of Alberta. The federal government has set up a judicial inquiry. CN Rail is conducting its own internal review. And safety officials of the Canadian Transport Commission have joined the search for clues at the crash site on an isolated stretch of track 16 kilometers from Hinton, Alberta. Ed Taylor reports.
The recovery team, made up of RCMP officers, Canadian National Police officers, and VIA and CN officials, concentrated their search for the entire day on the lead coach of the VIA train. That car, sliced almost in two and badly gutted by fire, is believed to contain most of the victims. Any bodies taken from the wreck today will be moved first to a makeshift morgue in Hinton before being transported to the office of the Alberta Medical Examiner. In Edmonton today, autopsies were being done on the first two bodies taken from the wreck yesterday. CN officials believe they are the bodies of the engineer of the VIA train and a female passenger. Well-known names have been released. The VIA train was only bound as far as Winnipeg. Dr. Derek Pounder, the medical examiner on the scene, admitted that there could be more than the 27 bodies in the 52-seat passenger car. There is a possibility that some people could have boarded the train without making a reservation. An emergency hotline telephone set up by CN Rail has received calls from friends or family of all but seven of the known passengers. Three other people of the 122 people on the two trains are known to the recovery team only as passengers X.
Those persons, as you heard yesterday, could have purchased tickets within 1 hour of the train's arrival in Hinton, and they were recorded on the VIA computer system as X. Not only that, there is the potential for people to have got onto the train in Hinton and intending to pay their fare without recording or purchasing a ticket in the Hinton office.
It will take at least 2 days to clear the wreckage from the track. In the meantime, the shoe fly or detour route has already been constructed. Trains should be moving once again on the CN main line through here by late tonight. Ed Taylor, Global News, near Hinton, Alberta.
Since that report was filed, there has been a dramatic new development in efforts to reach the bodies of those who died in the crash. Ed Taylor has this late telephone report.
Most of the work today centered on the lead VIA Rail coach, where the RCMP and CN officials believe the 21 bodies yet to be accounted for are located. The main problem was the huge grain hopper, still more than half full of wheat, resting on top of the battered coach. Just before nightfall, that hopper car was lifted out of the way, and searchers were able to see for the first time inside the passenger compartment. They'd expected that once access to the VIA coach was made, there would be little difficulty in removing the bodies. What they found inside, however, caused the RCMP investigation team to summon the Alberta Deputy Medical Examiner, Dr. Derek Pounder, from Edmonton. He flew in just 45 minutes ago and is on the scene now. Dr. Pounder, who is the coroner assigned to the accident investigation, would only say the recovery team has run into major difficulties and a decision would have to be made about the removal of the bodies.
The Canadian member of an international delegation monitoring the Philippines election says he's shocked by the cheating he's seen. Liberal Senator Al Graham says he's seen examples of people voting more than once or not being allowed to vote at all. Both President Ferdinand Marcos and opposition candidate Corazon Aquino are claiming victory. And as they wait for a final verdict, their supporters are nervously waiting in the streets of Manila. Steve Mallory reports.
The potential for violence was there. Aquino backers with yellow banners. Marcos supporters with red, white, and blue. The police were ready. But at least here, there was no violence. They gathered outside the parliament, whose members are required to conduct the official vote count. They began that task today.
The count is at a critical moment.
Senator Richard Lugar and other American observers left for home today, saying that in no way could this election be described as clean.
Even within the last 24 hours, serious charges have been made in regard to the tabulation system.
Lugar was talking about the government's unofficial vote counting center. The results here have been tainted. Last night, 30 computer operators walked off the job, claiming the count was rigged in favor of President Marcos.
We will not stop now.
Mrs. Aquino was out again yesterday, urging her backers to be vigilant to counter attempts to cheat her out of the election.
This woman of peace who stands before you today is claiming the people's due, the presidency.
An hour after Mrs. Aquino made her speech, one of her supporters at the site was shot dead, the 95th victim of election violence. With the outcome still in doubt, soldiers are patrolling the nation's capital more than usual to discourage violence should there be any protests against the final results.
The biggest mafia trial in Italian history began today in Palermo, Sicily. 474 mobsters have been charged with offenses ranging from murder to drug trafficking. But as Bonnie Anderson reports, not everyone is sure that this latest effort to smash the power of the mafia will work.
The accused gangsters were seated in 27 cages along the far wall of the $43 million courtroom. It was the first time many of them had seen each other since their arrest. With almost 500 defendants, 400 lawyers, and 200,000 documents, the trial is expected to take more than a year. The trial grew out of an investigation begun in 1982 by Italy's top mafia fighter, Carlo Alberto Dalla Chiesa. He uncovered evidence of a new, deadlier mafia, greedy over billion-dollar drug profits. 6 months later, he was killed. The state star witness is Tommaso Buscetta, the most senior godfather ever to break the mafia code of silence, omerta. His confession led to hundreds of arrests here and in the United States. Among the charges, murder, kidnapping, and drug trafficking. 5,000 students marched through Palermo Saturday, urging the authorities to continue their fight against organized crime. But perhaps even more revealing, hundreds of construction workers held a public rally a day earlier in support of the mob. To them, the mafia means jobs. For centuries, Sicilian gangs have controlled virtually all forms of commerce here. They are the employers, the owners.
Many people here doubt the police will ever be able to rid Sicily of organized crime. The authorities, they say, are fighting more than the mafia. They're fighting tradition. Bonnie Anderson, NBC News, Palermo.
Haiti's new military leader today pledged to hold general and presidential elections. Lieutenant General Henri Nanfi also promised to respect human rights, support the development of political parties, and draft a new constitution. But perhaps the most important announcement today was the outlawing of the hated secret police, the Tonton Macout. Dozens of the militiamen have been killed since deposed leader Jean-Claude Duvalier fled the country on Friday. The main airport in the capital of Port-au-Prince has been closed. But an Air Canada jumbo jet was allowed to land and bring about 400 Canadians home. Kevin Newman reports on the plane's arrival in Montreal.
It is the first and so far the only passenger jet to leave Haiti since Jean-Claude Duvalier's escape. It was obvious many of the passengers were relieved to be home. Their departure from Haiti had been delayed by the new government's strict law forbidding travel out of the country. Most of the families waiting had been in telephone contact with relatives, but no one knew just who would or would not be on board the rescue jet. Many had witnessed the street violence. There were stories of Haitian children begging for money to kill Tonton Macoud, the feared Duvalier secret police. This woman became trapped by the street violence and couldn't reach her children for a day.
I want to find my kids, and I was very scared.
Do you see anything, any violence?
Yeah, for sure.
What kind of violence?
You know, people just trying to get some macoutes and everything, you know, just try to get them.
Canadian authorities stressed this was not an evacuation of Canadians from Haiti, merely a way of rescuing stranded vacationers. But only half of the passengers aboard the Air Canada flight were tourists. An external affairs official says about 200 passengers were the families of Canadian relief workers who had left out of concern for their safety. There were also a small number of Americans and Europeans on board. This man says some Canadians vacationing at a Club Med were never told about the flight.
Yeah, they weren't told exactly what's happening, because what's happening is bad, but on the club you don't see any of this. And they should have told them, because it might be the last flight there for the next month.
428 people did leave, many with unpleasant memories of the frenzied jubilation, looting, and revenge that came after the sudden end of the Duvalier regime. Kevin Newman, Global News, Mirabel.
Now here's Jim Taddy with a look at what Sportsline will be featuring tonight.
Thank you, Jan. Just one game in the NHL tonight. Minnesota has beaten Montreal 4-3 in overtime. Highlights of that later on. Also, Sean O'Sullivan fought tonight. His opponent, Tomas Garcia of Mexico. Sean won it with a second-round knockout, and there it is right there. The complete story on Sportsline at 11:30. Jan?
Thanks very much. And coming up, accusations that NASA officials knew about a problem that might have caused the space shuttle explosion.
Your sign. What's the big deal?
It's Shell's big deal on a meal.
For real? Huh. What's the spiel?
You fill up at Shell and for a penny, we'll seal the deal with over $2 in coupons on Swiss Chalet and Hardee's meals.
Save over $2 on quarter chicken dinners and hamburger meals? Wow. Unreal.
So how do you feel about Shell's big deal on a meal?
It's a steal.
Why do you think they call us Shell dealers?
Shell dealers help.
My most embarrassing moment with my dentures, last year's family reunion. They were taking pictures, and when I said, cheese, my dentures nearly fell out. They even got it on film. Then Aunt Ruth told me about Super Polygrip.
Super Polygrip gives a real firm hold and helps keep food from getting under your dentures and irritating your gums.
Now I always use Super Polygrip.
Super Polygrip helps keep food out, dentures in.
I don't want to be camera shy.
We're very proud of Qantas. It's the airline of our country.
Australia.
Of course, Australia's not a hop across the country. It's a hop across the hemispheres.
But after 65 years' experience, you know how to do it right, mate.
And on Qantas, you get to meet one of the world's rare breeds, Aussie.
So come on. You'll love Qantas. Everyone does. Well, almost everyone.
A simple white Valentine with red printing has been mailed to all 282 federal MPs. The cards are from the homosexual group Gays of Ottawa. And the Valentine message calls for the MPs to care equally for Canadians by expanding the Charter of Rights to protect homosexuals from discrimination. Prime Minister Mulroney was in southern Ontario today for a trip with one clear aim, public relations. Larry Jackson reports on Mr. Mulroney's five-hour visit to the St. Catharines area.
The Armed Forces Charter arrived at Niagara District Airport 45 minutes behind schedule. Because he was so late, the dozen or so who turned out to meet Brian Mulroney on this Meet the People trip were restricted to a quick glimpse as the Prime Minister made tracks for Fraser Paper, Thorold Division. Here there was a 15-minute tour through a plant so loud that the employees had to wear ear protectors as they were meeting the Prime Minister. Then into a seminar room to talk with some workers retrained under a $250,000 government grant. Fraser management was pleased that Mr. Mulroney showed up. They were also a little puzzled about why.
Because the company did not invite them. We're glad to have them, but we didn't take the initiative to invite them.
This trip is supposed to improve the Prime Minister's public image. It may have with the media, who dogged his every step, but at least some of the Fraser workers see it otherwise.
Simple question.
Yeah.
He's here to try to improve his image. Is he improving his image?
Not to me, he's not.
Okay,
where was he when we needed him?
Okay, we don't just go for promise. When we get something, promise something, we want to see.
Towards supper hour, Mulroney arrived at a conservative cocktail party at which he was given a conservative reception, polite applause, even to a speech that was down on the liberals and high on the conservative record.
We're all Canadians. All Canadians have a place in the sun.
He was very precise, and he explained the benefits since the Conservatives came in power. I was very impressed.
This is the second Meet the People trip the Prime Minister has taken on in recent weeks. In a crowd like this one, it's obviously successful. But whether it is generally is still up to discussion. Regardless, the Prime Minister's staff seems to think that it can't hurt. Larry Jackson, Global News, St. Catharines.
NASA has canceled the next three space shuttle flights because of the explosion that destroyed the shuttle Challenger. Meanwhile, NASA investigators are still studying the booster rockets that might have played a role in the disaster. Robert Bozell reports.
Just before the shuttle exploded, there was a leak of exhaust from the right solid rocket booster. Investigators are focusing on a seam in that rocket where the leak apparently occurred, trying to find out how the leak began. Even before the accident, the company which manufactures the rocket had been trying to redesign the seam, according to sources familiar with the investigation. NASA and the company thought the seam could be a source of future problems, these sources say. The rockets are assembled at the Kennedy Space Center from four sections shipped from the Morton Thiokol Company in Utah. At each joint, two O-rings similar to washers are inserted. Here is a close-up of a cross-section of the joint. On previous missions, exhaust from the rocket fuel had gone past one of the two rings, and officials were concerned it could leak past the other. So NASA and the company were considering a design using a third ring. But NASA officials did not believe the problem serious enough to halt the shuttle program, so the new design was only under study. Investigators still do not know what caused the leak, but they are focusing on several possibilities. One is that part of the rocket came loose from the shuttle at the time of launch, putting stress on the seam. Another is that unusual winds stressed the seam after launch. Another focus is the cold weather the morning of launch. NASA has ordered tests to determine whether the cold could have damaged the O-rings. And investigators are concerned about the insulating chemical, which is supposed to keep the rocket fuel away from the seam. NASA has said almost nothing about the possible cause of the explosion. William Rogers, chairman of the Presidential Commission investigating the accident, has said there will be some answers at the public meeting of his panel tomorrow. Robert Bozell, NBC News, New York.
Still to come on the National Edition, Everybody's Business with Everett Banning, Martha Howlett's weather forecast, and an actor with a well-known dislike for institutions has a proposition for voters in a California town.
Make my day.
There's heart in this land, it's there in all we do. That's where hands across this country reach for the blue.
At Labatt's, we've had a single goal since 1847, and that's to brew Canada's best-tasting beer. That's why we brew Labatt's Blue the Pilsner way, so you can enjoy that clean, true taste.
Perfection that moves you around the world as easily as around the corner. Perfection that brings you imaginative new choices in phones and services. And new ideas, like call forwarding and call waiting. When it comes to getting what you pay for, come to Bell, where perfection is the only game we play.
Friday, March 14, you could make a splash in the provincial's big spring bonus draw.
There are 100 special bonus prizes of $25,000 plus 5 shots at $500,000 over 5 weeks, all on one ticket. The Provincial's Big Spring Bonus Draw on Friday, March 14. Take your best shot.
Someday soon, communities like this could satisfy all their energy needs with a single remarkable fuel. This fuel will warm their homes, heat their water, and through an efficient fuel cell could also light their lights and run all their equipment. Already this fuel is powering thousands of vehicles. This fuel is Canadian natural gas. Natural gas. We're putting our energy into research.
Everybody's Business is brought to you by Canon, makers of the new AP300 electronic typewriter, priced to replace your electric. Canon, simply brilliant.
Good evening. Venezuela is the latest major oil-producing country to drop price fixing and move to market-set prices for its crude oil. Mexico's also cut oil prices. Both countries are major suppliers to eastern Canada. This means that our eastern refineries will start getting cheaper crude in the weeks ahead, with probable long-term benefits for consumers. Economists believe that the recent steep drops in world oil prices will be more beneficial than harmful to the industrial countries.
It's estimated that every $5 a barrel drop in the price of oil will add another 0.75% to the gross national product growth of the industrialized nations, including Canada.
For example, a $5 cut in oil prices, which seems at least likely, is equivalent to a $130 billion tax cut for the world economy, stimulating demand, stimulating growth in real GNP.
A projection by the Economic Council of Canada found that lower oil prices could push inflation in Canada down to 2.5% and unemployment down to only 7.5%. But regions dependent upon the oil industry will suffer.
It means that Oklahomans can drive up to the service station and get oil and gas, get oil products, maybe 10 cents a gallon cheaper. But it also may mean he's out of work when he buys it.
The oil industry got used to selling its product for as much as $40 a barrel over the past 10 years, a price level which allowed energy companies to develop expensive projects such as the Western oil sands and the Canadian Arctic drilling program. With some oil now going on the spot market for as little as $15 a barrel, only traditional oil supplies, such as those found in the prairies, will have a chance of remaining profitable.
Federal regulators are acting against hockey pucks dumped into Canada at unfair prices from Czechoslovakia and East Germany. Imports have grabbed almost two-thirds of the Canadian hockey puck market. And the new Canadian-owned Gulf Canada today became the largest new listing ever on the American Stock Exchange in New York, with 230 million shares listed. The Canadian dollar resumed its strong climb upwards again today, but the Toronto stock market gave some ground due to oil prices. New York, however, hit yet another all-time high as its more diverse index benefited from strong economic indicators. The TSE 300 lost 5.86, the Dow gained 12.96 to a record 1626. Gold lost a dollar, and our dollar bounced up a further 43 points to 71.50 U.S. That's Everybody's Business tonight. I'm Everett Banning.
Everybody's Business is brought to you by Canon, makers of the new personal copier, the ultra-small copier that costs about as much as a typewriter. Canon's personal copier.
Align and balance tires, replace sparks.
Net profit before taxes.
Cheese, dog food, crackers, $4.23.
That's $30 from petty cash.
Sales, $60 million. Let's see now.
No matter what kind of business you're in, there's a Canon calculator to make numbers easier.
That's my number.
Canon calculators. Now more than ever, we're minding everybody's business.
Microwave network facilities for global news are provided by CNCP.
Want to cut the high cost of business communications? There's only one call you have to make. Call us. CNCP Telecommunications.
With a look at tomorrow's weather forecast, here's Martha Howlett.
Another pleasant day coming up in the weather. We've got some sunshine. Temperatures aren't too bad, about normal for this time of the year. Today we had the effects, just the remnants of a low pressure system which is centered way up in Labrador, and some cloud, especially in the northern regions today. But that should be moving out, leaving us with just a few clouds tomorrow, but we're calling for mostly sunshine. That's from a ridge of high pressure centered right now in Saskatchewan, moving down into the Dakotas. We take a look at the map for tomorrow, we'll see that high in the Dakotas, clearing things out, pushing those clouds off to the east. And the forecast looks like this. We're looking at sunshine for the southwest, and temperatures won't be bad either, minus 6 degrees Celsius. The southeast is similar, partly sunny with temperatures up around minus 8 degrees. Now, those are daytime highs, and includes everywhere from Windsor to Ottawa and Toronto. For central regions, North Bay, Sudbury, partly sunny, minus 12 degrees Celsius. And for the north, partly cloudy. Chance of light snow, that's the remnants of that low pressure system. And also a high of minus 12 degrees Celsius. That's the weather.
English writer Graham Greene received a special and exclusive gift from the Queen today. He has been made a member of the Order of Merit. The prestigious distinction is limited to only 24 people at any one time and is more valued than a knighthood. Mr. Greene has had 49 books published and is regarded by many critics as the finest living writer of English. And finally tonight, Carmel is a gorgeous little town on the California coast. The people that run it want to keep it that way. But one prominent citizen thinks the establishment is squeezing the life out of Carmel. And as George Lewis reports, this man packs a heavy reputation.
Over the years, Mayor Townsend and the Carmel City Council have passed tough ordinances to keep the city from growing, changing, or getting dirty.
There's a lot of dumb rules around here, you know, like there's no dogs allowed in the park, things like that, and no frisbee throwing in there either.
In spite of objections from businessmen, there's a rule against putting in more parking downtown. To prevent litter, there's a rule against fast food joints. And recently, Carmel made it almost impossible to open any more ice cream parlors. A lot of people found that oppressive and silly.
You know, I hate to have to eat my ice cream behind closed doors.
The council really stirred things up, though, when it refused the owner of this restaurant permission to build a business office next door. This time, they took on the wrong guy.
Go ahead. Make my day.
Clint Eastwood, movie actor and Carmel businessman, has thrown down the gauntlet in real life. He is running against the mayor.
I'd be very happy to have him make everybody's day in the movie theater, but I would not like to have him remake our village.
But a lot of young people who think the city is run by old fogies favor Eastwood.
This town needs a change, and Clint Eastwood's got my vote.
Oh! Elect the guy who plays Dirty Harry? A lot of older voters have reservations.
I don't care for him, that's all. I just can't think of him as mayor as Carmel.
This is a media circus in one of Eastwood's movies. Because he doesn't want that in the election, Eastwood has been reluctant to meet the press.
I can't talk to him.
However, a local station found him on the golf course.
And I've watched sort of a negative pall come over the community in recent years.
He blames the negative pall on elected officials and says he wants to reverse that. So, the big showdown looms. We will know after the April 8th balloting whose day the voters made. George Lewis, NBC News, Carmel by the Sea.
And that's the National Edition. I'm Jan Tennant. Good night from all of us at Global News. And stay tuned for Sportsline, coming up next.
Just a reminder, Late Night with Letterman will be seen 1/2 hour later than usual tonight, beginning at 1. Tonight, David's special guest is Billy Crystal.
$250 Cadillacs? Ever hear of anything like it? Why, they're practically giving them away. They are. Scratch the right Super Lotto ticket and off you go in a brand new Cadillac? Ever drive a Cadillac?
Mm-mm.
What do you do for fun?
You could win one of 250 Cadillacs, the Dandevilles, each month in the new January and February Super Lotto Instant Scratch Bonus.
250 Cadillacs. That's more caddies than the Canadian Open.
Your home looks great.
Hey, thanks.
Just think, in 25 years, you'll own it.
With Royal Trust,
we'll have our home paid for in 14 years.
Yeah,
here you win the lottery.
Oh, we can double our payment any month we want.
There's no mortgage like it. By doubling just twice a year, we can pay off our Royal Trust mortgage in just 14 years.
And save a ton of interest.
What a financial partner should be.
Can we double up this month?
You can double up any time you want.
It's more than a taste, bigger than a name, as big as your best times, as good as your best friends, as real as the way you feel. Coke, Diet Coke, Coca-Cola Classic. It's the way you said it should be, because you know what you've always known. You've got it all.
Jason and Maggie desperately try to grab a little private time for romance on Growing Pains, tomorrow at 8:30 on the Global Television Network.
Live from Toronto, this is Sportsline.
Tonight, Sean O'Sullivan makes it 10-0 as a pro. He beat up Mexico's Tomas Nomas Garcia.
Alexis Arguello scores an impressive win as he starts his comeback. Mark goes over yesterday's bout.
Just one game in the NHL tonight, a dandy between the Habs and Minnesota at the Forum in Montreal.
Dieter Brock talks to us about living and playing in L.A. with the Rams and the pressure to win every time out.
And two Heisman Trophy winners in one backfield. It might happen if the Cowboys can get Herschel Walker to run with Tony Dorsett. Good evening, everyone. I'm Mark Hedson.
And I'm Jim Taddy. Also tonight, Jim Benning out for quite some time. Georgetown St. John's highlights from tonight. Football injuries and loads more tonight from Sportsline.
Tonight's trivia, name the boxer who beat Sean O'Sullivan for the gold medal at the 84 Summer Olympics. His last loss, by the way. 870-9157. Come on, you boxing fans. We'll have highlights of Sean's quick win in 60 seconds.
This is a Toyota truck. It's built to work hard. It comes in this one-ton shape, fuel-injected with a double-wall bed. It comes van-shaped with more cargo room than other small vans. And it comes extra-cab long bed-shaped with more bedroom and an optional automatic column shift for real three-across seating. Whatever the shape, Toyota trucks work hard. Rugged Toyota truck, the solid choice.
Who could ask for anything more? Toyota!
Lovely morning, isn't it, Tina?
Mr. Ashburn's on his way down.
For you, Mr. Ashburn? To see me?
Yes, sir.
Why me?
His rush parcel wasn't picked up last night.
Did our courier forget to pick it up?
That's what he wants to talk to you about.
Don't wait until the boss storms into your office. Priority Post Courier delivers overnight to every major city in Canada. Call Priority Post Courier and relax.
Welcome back to Sportsline. Sean O'Sullivan grabs the lead tonight. His 10th pro fight win in Toronto. His opponent, Tomas Garcia of Mexico. Let's go over what happened. Please don't blink. You'll miss it. All right, let's consider the action in the first round. Both fighters basically feeling each other out. Garcia will land probably, well, heck, it was his best punch of the night, and you'll see that coming up. And then some action that is indicative of his night. He slips. And this is the highlight of the fight today.
Hello.
The ring card girl. We'll give her about a 9.5. Garcia again tags O'Sullivan, but it just seems to wake him up. And after this tag, you'll see them exchange combos. No big connection. No foreshadowing of what would happen in round three. And you see them just basically sparring with each other. Nothing really dangerous at this point. And, well, Garcia looks a little spirited. What the heck? There they are between rounds, and let's go to round three. O'Sullivan will tag Garcia coming in. You're going to see plenty of action here. We'll end up in Garcia's corner, and you have to watch for a right from O'Sullivan. He really delivers it. It's coming up right here in the downward motion, and, well, there it is right there. Turn out the lights after the fight. O'Sullivan had these comments.
I started out kind of slow, feeling that this opponent would take me 10 rounds. I started out slow, worked the combinations as the bout continued on, but I fortunately caught him with a good right hand at the right time.
If he was looking for one punch, he just couldn't land that big punch.
I sure couldn't. Meanwhile, the sport of boxing, as you saw there, has suffered recently from a lack of good talent, I'm not talking about Sean, and a lack of classy fighters. No mention of Sean there either. Yesterday, the cream once again rose to the top as Alexis Arguello made a successful comeback in Reno, Nevada.